we'll be updating those impacted communities as soon as possible. And I'm really reaching out to all of those volunteers and those community members at the moment who are busy preparing for this flood. It's obviously a very big concern for the Bureau and our partner agencies. And I'll hand across to Greg Sword, who's going to give a bit of Swindles, I should say, who's going to give a bit of an update on the SES response.
Yeah, thanks, Justin. Greg Swindles, Chief Superintendent from the New South Wales State Emergency Service. As we've just heard from Justin, a particular concern for us is around the Forbes Township, the Lachlan River. We're certainly well prepared out there. We have significant resources, both local and emergency service partners assisting us out there, Rural Fire Service and Fire Rescue New South Wales, our local SES members, plus out-of-area deployments from around the state. Since this event did commence, we've seen approximately 1,500 requests for assistance come from members of the public around the state. Around the Forbes area in the last 24 hours, 100 calls for assistance, mainly relating to sandbags. But what I can say is that the community out at Forbes are quite resilient. They've been preparing for this with us and other the local council since June, and they're quite prepared out there. We did yesterday afternoon issue an evacuation warning. Provided by the guidance that we're receiving from the Bureau, that could be updated to an evacuation order for up to 800 properties in the low-lying areas around the Forbes Township. And that could come out as early as late this afternoon or later this evening in preparation for what we've just heard is coming. At the peaks, it could be as early as now as what I've just heard during Wednesday. What we ask the members of the community in the Forbes area is to listen to the warnings and the advice that we give them, respond to that advice, and to look after themselves and do what's asked of them to do to stay safe. Of concern for us, and it always is when we do see floods, since this event has occurred, and this is statewide, 29 flood rescues we have seen. We stand here each time when we have floods, and our advice is for people not to walk, drive, or ride through floodwaters. Unfortunately, people still take that risk. At this point in time, those flood rescues have all been successful for us, but I just want to say it again, please, people, do not drive into floodwaters. You're putting yourself at danger, your family's at danger, and also our volunteers and our emergency service workers that are coming in to rescue you. So please take notice of the advice that we give you. And the other jobs that we have seen have been strong winds with trees down as well. So I think that's it for me, unless there's any further questions.
Justin, can I just ask you a quick question? You mentioned that the peak time is now looking like Wednesday, but as I understand it, the waters are already coming up, and so from tomorrow afternoon we're going to sort of see some fairly high water levels, and it's just going to continue to slowly progress upwards. Is that sort of the understanding of it?
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah, the water levels are continuing to slowly rise at Forbes. So we're expecting it to exceed that major flood level Tuesday into Wednesday early morning, and then we hopefully we'll see that flood peak occur on Wednesday. So currently the flood waters are at Nanaimo. We're expecting that to peak over the next 24 hours, and once that peaks there, that'll give us a better idea on the timing of the flood waters to peak at Forbes. And I think it's really important to say is that, you know, at Nanaimo, the flood level is actually higher than 2016. So we're obviously concerned that the flood levels at Forbes may reach levels as high as 2016 and even possibly higher. So we're keeping very close eye on those flood forecasts and warnings and how those river levels are rising, and we'll be updating those warnings and forecasts as soon as we've got new information that can help those communities prepare.
So in terms of what that means, I guess, for people tomorrow night, it's going to be one of those situations where they need to keep watching quite late into the evening, because I guess where they go to bed is not where the floodwaters are necessarily going to wake up. It's going to be one of those ones that's going to run over at night time, isn't it, potentially?
I think one fortunate thing about the floods in Western New South Wales, they're a slow-moving, evolving event. And I think what's really important is for people just to keep abreast of those latest river level rises and those latest forecasts over the next few days. And hopefully we'll be able to provide them adequate warning and lead time for them to prepare ahead of the floods actually arriving and impacting their personal properties and communities.
Greg, we've seen a massive response out of those communities over the last couple of days. It must be one of the more heartening ones, I guess, from your perspective, just seeing the way that everyone seems to have rallied and the resources have actually been able to get moved up there pretty quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. It's certainly encouraging not only the local members of the community that are helping themselves, our volunteers, obviously that's why they volunteer, but to help their own communities, but significant resources from the local council and our other emergency service providers. As I did mention before, we also have out-of-area deployments of SES personnel from around the state that are up there as well. I believe that we had 30 teams out in the field yesterday up there, door-knocking those at-risk properties, those 800 properties, to give them forewarning. And upwards of over 100 volunteers of our SES who really just stand up at times like these to help members of their community. They're outstanding at the work that they do.